VTOL aircraft were developing into a very practical military answer during the Cold War, for locations with short runways or without runways at all. Germany worked hard to get its own versions into service, ranging from the VJ-101 interceptor to the Dornier DO-31 transporter, and the British had demonstrated the viability of the concept with the Harrier. So, the Soviet Union took the hint and developed a few ideas in an effort to put its own VTOL aircraft into service. Today, I will be showing you the Yakovlev 141 Freestyle. One of these ideas was the Yak-39 Forger, a VTOL aircraft that resembled the Harrier that had limited use in the Soviet Navy and was far from successful. The Yakovlev company also produced the Yak-41, but by NATO, it was given the name Freestyle. The first prototype of the Yak-41 was completed in 1987, and a total of 4 prototype aircraft were built, 2 for static tests and 2 for flight tests. It was intended that this larger, supersonic VTOL aircraft would replace the Yak-38, which was always seen as somewhat of a temporary solution. At that time, the Soviet Union did not have large aircraft carriers, so it decided to build fighters that could take off from narrow platforms, such as the Project 1123 class cruisers, Moscow, Leningrad, and Kiev. It didn't take long for the Yak-141 to be created as a viable replacement, but the larger and more complicated aircraft only saw limited use as a test aircraft before the Soviet Union gave up on its VTOL aspirations. The Yak-38 was not robust enough for the Soviet Navy, which desired a machine with more capabilities. Yakovlev was given a contract to build a VTOL aircraft. Shortly after demonstrating their ability to do so, an aircraft with comparable armament loads, radar, and maneuverability to existing frontline fighters was exactly what the Navy envisioned. With this new aircraft, which would be the VTOL fighter of the next generation, Yakovlev thought they could once again lead the Soviet fighter design. Designers from the Yakovlev Bureau selected a layout with one engine, which rotates 95 degrees downwards, known as a rotating nozzle. 2 more vertical thrust engines were also present, located in the center of the fuselage, directly behind the center of gravity. Only when hovering, landing vertically, or taking off vertically, will this engine ignite. Yakovlev was able to get financing to build 4 prototype aircraft, one of which would be a bare airframe for static and fatigue testing. The aircraft resembled the MiG-25 Foxbat in appearance. The Yak-141 had its maiden conventional flight on March 9, 1987, but it wasn't until December 29, 1989, more than 2 years later, that the aircraft made its first hovering flight. In 1991, during the flight, Chief Test Pilot Sinitsyn went on to set 12 new world records. However, because the Yak-41 designation was classified, the records were submitted under the fictitious name Yak-141. As a result, the previously unidentified aircraft became known as the Yak-141 in the West. The Russian tricolor insignia was added to both flying aircraft in 1992, and Yakovlev painted a white 141 over their former call signs of 75 and 77 to replace them. It wouldn't be long before the program began to experience problems. The aircraft showed some potential at first. Ski jumps and regular runways were used for takeoffs, and the aircraft was capable of maintaining a vertical flight. Sinitsyn accomplished the first vertical landing on the aircraft carrier Admiral Gorshkov on September 26, 1991. Vladimir A. Yakimov landed on the same deck an hour later. The pilots would go on to make 8 flights from the ship until Yakimov made a hard landing on the 5th of October. A fuel tank was ruptured by the undercarriage, sparking a large fire. Yakimov successfully ejected after nearly 30 seconds and was recovered from the water. The plane was quickly fixed and placed on display, but funding was running out. In 1992, the Yak-141 program was finally scrapped. Moreover, in 1995, Russia decommissioned all the Kiev-class aircraft carriers, and for the Yak-141, that meant its main landing platforms. The aircraft was highly complicated for its period, and didn't end up being any better than the Yak-38, which was already plagued by a number of problems. Also, the Soviet Union was crumbling by the early 1990s, so there was very little reason to continue working on a technology that the Soviet Union had not yet mastered. The Yak-141 was among the more exciting VTOL designs at the time, and the Soviet Union had ambitions to develop additional models. Another supersonic VTOL plane, the Yak-43, was intended to be a development of the Yak-141, but was never developed past the conceptual stage. During the Cold War, the Soviet Union was not the only country aiming for supersonic VTOL aircraft. Britain came dangerously close to developing the P-1154, a supersonic variant of the popular Harrier. A real supersonic VTOL aircraft wouldn't reach military service until the American F-35. Many nations expressed interest in the aircraft, but no orders were ever placed, although a document from 1993 that is quoted from the Bulgarian military page on the NASA website states that the US planned to research all advancements made to the Yak-141 and Yak-38 aircraft. It is known that Lockheed Martin and Yakovlev partnered to continue development of the Yak-141 aircraft around the beginning of the 1990s. It is probable that Lockheed Martin used the money provided to build more Yak-141 prototypes as a cover to acquire technical information for the project. Between 1991 to 1997, Yakovlev and Lockheed Martin worked together, and soon after, American VTOL fighter development started to advance. In 2000, the first X-35A prototype was released and made its first flight. In the end, the Yak-141 arrived much too late in the Soviet Union's history to have any genuine hope of succeeding. In 1991, both the Soviet Union and the Cold War in its entirety would end. The Yak-141 did, in fact, appear at the 1992 Farnborough Air Show as a Russian aircraft, not a Soviet aircraft. The Yak-141 had a lot of potential, but it was too expensive and didn't provide much of a benefit to the Soviet Navy, which had initially fought so hard for it. What are your thoughts on the Yakovlev 141 Freestyle? Do you think that the Soviet Union should have kept pursuing the VTOL idea, or given it up? Let me know in the comments. As usual, thank you all for watching, and if you'd like to see more strange aircraft-related content, you can check out the playlist above. Or, you can watch another video from my channel. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and if you enjoyed, I will hopefully see you in my next video.